Welcome to another edition of Ask NEI. I'm Dr. Andrew Cutler, the Chief Medical Officer of the Neuroscience Education Institute, and I want to thank you so much for joining us today. Today we are live from the Synapse meeting in Austin, Texas, and we've got a really exciting meeting planned. It's a hybrid meeting. It's both live and you can join us virtually, and it's not too late to register to attend virtually. We're going to get started tomorrow, Friday morning, and it's going to go through Sunday. So we've got 3 days of action-packed excitement. Now, for those of you who may not be familiar with Ask NEI, this is a feature where we solicit your questions on any topic. Today is any topic. Sometimes we have a theme, but today is any topic regarding psychopharmacology, anything that you're curious about or you're wondering, and I'll do my best to give you an answer, and if I don't know, I'll certainly admit it, and I'll tell you maybe where we can both find out the answer. Now, today is open to not just our NEI membership, which Ask NEI sometimes is limited to, but we're going out over many different channels, YouTube, LinkedIn, Facebook. So wherever you are, get comfortable and let's get started. So first here, I've got some questions. And oh, if you have any questions, please type them into the chat box or send them in to us, and we'll just take them as we go along. We're going to be here for at least a half an hour, maybe a little bit longer. So our first question is, what are your thoughts of the efficacy of stimulants for increasing mood? And if you were to use a stimulant, would you use it adjunctively, I guess added to an antidepressant, or as monotherapy? Well, do I have a surprise for you? Quick quiz, trivia time. Do you know what the first medication FDA approved in the United States to treat depression actually was? Well, if you say tricyclic antidepressant, you'd be close, but you'd be wrong. If you said monoamine oxidase inhibitor, same thing, close, but no cigar. It turns out it was amphetamine. That's right, benzedrine, which is racemic D and L amphetamine, was actually approved in 1939 in the U.S. to treat depression. As a matter of fact, it's really funny. I went back and looked up some things. I found the AMA, the American Medical Association, back then was actually encouraging doctors to prescribe amphetamines. You wouldn't see that today, that's for sure. So there is a long history of the efficacy of stimulants for treating mood disorders, especially depression. Also, methylphenidate, racemic methylphenidate, known as Ritalin, was of course approved in the late 1950s, and that was one of the approvals was actually for mild depression, for mild forms of depression, if you will. And there's a whole literature of adding stimulants to antidepressants for various patients with mood disorders, but especially with methylphenidate in those who had medical conditions and also some who had cognitive impairment such as dementias. So it certainly makes sense. It's very rational. And I would say that it's definitely in the algorithm when you're treating a unipolar major depressive disorder, MDD. Now, where it really gets tricky and complicated is in bipolar disorder. And what I would say there is if somebody is adequately mood stabilized, meaning they're on a mood stabilizer such as lithium or an anticonvulsant, or especially an atypical antipsychotic that's approved for bipolar, you can safely add a stimulant. I've done it many times, and they won't get manic or psychotic, which is really the fear, right? There have been a couple of large meta-analyses now published that show that not only do bipolar patients not get worse, they get demonstrably better as far as mood and cognition when a stimulant is added to an adequate mood stabilizing regimen. So this is something that may be a little surprising. Of course, there are certain caveats. I would be very careful in anybody who has active substance abuse or a history of substance abuse that's not been really well stabilized, that the person isn't really well motivated and has a plan to maintain sobriety. So it's not necessarily for everybody. But it's fascinating that historically, there is this database and there is abundant evidence. Of course, we don't have any of them FDA approved. Now, several years ago, I was the lead investigator on a study with lisdexamfetamine, which is the amphetamine prodrug, added to antidepressants to treat major unipolar major depression disorder. And we did a pilot phase 2 study that was positive, and I'm an author on this study with Madhukar Trivedi. Unfortunately, when we ramped it up into a large phase 3 registration program, it didn't beat placebo, which is shocking considering that history I just told you and all of the evidence that's been published. And the issue was there were probably methodologic issues and placebo response was very high, and that probably blunted the outcome. So, great questions. So as far as adjunctively or monotherapy, I don't think I would use a stimulant as monotherapy for depression. I think I would tend to use it as an adjunct for either unipolar depression or for bipolar depression. Okay, what is your opinion on the idea that there are please keep submitting your questions. These are great. What's your opinion on the idea that there are subtypes of ADHD, and does that affect your choice of medication? Wow, that's a great question. Well, I do believe there are subtypes. The DSM-4 used to call them types. DSM-5 changed it to presentations. So we have three presentations of ADHD. We have the most common, about 2/3 of people, is the combined presentation. Next most common in 30-40% is the predominantly inattentive presentation. Now, if you think historically, that's probably what we used to call ADD. Remember that ADD now is a layman's term. It's not what we call it. The scientific or medical term is ADHD, as of DSM-3R, I believe. And you can have these different presentations. So what we used to call ADD is now ADHD, predominantly inattentive presentation. And then by far the least common, maybe 5%, is the predominantly hyperactive impulsive presentation. I believe in these, and I also believe there are people who don't fit neatly into these categories. ADHD, very heterogeneous biologically, and so to try to stuff it into these categories is obviously a little hard. It's a little bit arbitrary. But as far as treatments, currently no treatment is FDA approved for one presentation or subtype versus another. They're all approved for just ADHD. A few years ago, though, there was a medication that appeared to have best efficacy for the predominantly inattentive presentation, not as much for the hyperactive or combined. And the studies were done, but the FDA was reluctant to grant that kind of approval. So unfortunately, it really didn't go anywhere. But as we get more sophisticated, my hope, of course, is that we'll be able to have biomarkers and match up a medication with a certain mechanism of action that really matches with the specific neuropathology of that particular patient with ADHD. If you think about our treatment of choice these days, and they're very effective, our stimulants, they're really a blunt instrument. It's kind of like hitting the brain with a sledgehammer. You're just pushing up norepinephrine and dopamine kind of everywhere. And of course, the holy grail would be a non-stimulant that was equally effective or very effective. We do have a few non-stimulants available, and there is a new one on the market that's viloxazine extended release that was approved last year in April it was April Fool's Day, I believe, first or second, approved for children and adolescents. And April 29th, in just next week, there is a PDUFA date when the FDA will rule on the approval for viloxazine XR for adults. Now, the non-stimulants, of course, are not quite as efficacious. They haven't demonstrated the same level of efficacy as the stimulants. But certainly, there are a lot of drawbacks, as we know, to stimulants. So the hunt is really on. Okay, there is another related question here I want to get to. What about lemborexant combined with Provigil or Nuvigil? That's modafinil and armodafinil. Lemborexant is an orexin, a dual orexin receptor antagonist for insomnia and sleep. And I'm not sure if the question is regarding somebody who has insomnia, excessive daytime sleepiness, sleep apnea. Are we talking ADHD? I'm not sure. So let me kind of answer it in a variety of different ways. If I just think pharmacokinetically for a second, I don't think pharmacokinetically there's a problem, although that's one I don't keep off the top of my head. I'd have to look it up and make sure there isn't a pharmacokinetic interaction with one of these drugs interfering with the metabolism of another. Pharmacodynamically, of course, you would take the orexin antagonist in the evening and you would take modafinil or armodafinil in the morning. And they are, of course, doing opposite things. The orexin system is one of the brain's alerting and awakening systems. So blocking that, of course, tells the brain it's time to go to sleep. Whereas modafinil and armodafinil, we don't know exactly how they work, to be honest. It may be through the histamine system, actually, we think. But probably not going to interfere too much with each other as long as they're not given right on top of each other. So it's certainly a reasonable thing to consider. I know people, for instance, who take stimulants for ADHD who are taking a DORA, a dual orexin receptor antagonist, such as lemborexant or suvorexant, for sleep at night. So those certainly have been done. So I think that's the simple answer is, I don't see a very clear reason why you couldn't do that. It's a very interesting idea, interesting combination. Modafinil and armodafinil, of course, are for excessive daytime sleepiness associated with narcolepsy or obstructive sleep apnea. They are used off-label for ADHD. There is some positive data on them for ADHD, and they're certainly reasonable as non-stimulant options. Okay. I have a really important question from one of our NEI faculty, Dr. Jonathan Meyer. He must have heard my comment about Benzedrine, and he wanted to know who put the Benzedrine in Mrs. Murphy's Ovaltine. Well, Jonathan's the king of trivia, and I am not aware of this, but it's very possible that Ovaltine has probably been around a long time, and maybe one of the original formulations had Benzedrine in it. You know, back in those days, we were putting stimulants in all kinds of things. The original recipe for Coca-Cola, of course, included, we believe, derivatives of coca leaves, almost like cocaine. So I don't know, Jonathan. I'm hoping to see you in the next day or two, and maybe you'll tell me the answer to that one. Okay, I have another one, and these are great questions. Please keep sending them in. What is your opinion on the use of pregabalin in anxiety disorder and treatment-resistant depression? I would also throw in gabapentin, so we have gabapentin and pregabalin. My opinion for anxiety disorder is very favorable. Pregabalin, they actually did registration quality pivotal trials on pregabalin for GAD, generalized anxiety disorder, and they were very positive. The company at the last minute decided not to pursue that indication, believe it or not, which is really a shame because we need more options to treat anxiety, especially non-benzodiazepines. So pregabalin and gabapentin both have very significant evidence that they can work for anxiety, particularly generalized anxiety disorder. They're also used off-label for social anxiety disorder, maybe panic disorder, although I'm not as familiar with that kind of literature. I'm more familiar with GAD, excuse me, and social anxiety disorder. Okay, whoops. Oh, here we go, yeah. So certainly those make sense. They also, for a while we were kind of hopeful that gabapentin and pregabalin would help with bipolar disorder because some of the anticonvulsants do. Unfortunately, studies with gabapentin failed for bipolar disorder, but we all have patients, we all know individual patients who do very well on those medicines. And I think what might be happening is they really can help with sleep architecture, with sleep. They can help with anxiety and they can help with pain. And we know that patients with bipolar disorder have trouble with insomnia, with anxiety, and with pain. Patients with mood disorders have more pain, and there may even be an association of fibromyalgia with depression, for instance. So I think these are very reasonable options in those scenarios. As you know, pregabalin is FDA approved to treat fibromyalgia, for instance. Now, as far as treatment-resistant depression, they are not potent antidepressants, but it's certainly reasonable, again, to prescribe for insomnia and anxiety. We know that if a patient has depression with anxiety and or insomnia, they don't respond as well to our traditional reuptake inhibition antidepressants. We know they're harder to treat. We also know if you don't treat the anxiety, if there is residual anxiety or residual insomnia, those patients don't do as well. They have higher risk of relapse. They don't function as well. So we need to be very aggressive in treating those symptoms. And one way to do that is to use either gabapentin or pregabalin as augmentation. Again, not for the core depressed mood, but for these other associated symptoms that can be real modifiers of somebody's prognosis and outcome. Okay, super questions. Keep them coming. Oh boy, Oh boy, I'm going to take on one of those big ones here. We're going to take a big bite here. What is your best answer as a prescriber when a patient asks, how does lithium work? First of all, I would say I wish I knew, because we don't exactly know. Lithium is fascinating. Lithium's handled in the body like sodium. That means it's taken up into every single cell in the body. It's obviously cleared by the kidneys. So it's taken up into neurons, into all of the cells in the brain. And we do know some things about how it works. We know that it influences the inositol system and enhances phosphorylation, and that has effects on second messenger systems inside of neurons that can affect transcription and things like that. Also, lithium may stabilize membranes in the brain. Lithium has been shown to be highly neuroprotective. You can just ask my friend Jonathan Meyer, who I mentioned earlier. Jonathan and I take lithium every day. I'm going to stop for a second. I take lithium every day, but I take lithium orotate 5 milligrams. I'm not taking bipolar doses. And the reason why is because it's so neuroprotective. So I figure, what the heck, I'm going to try to protect my brain as best I can. So lithium is very neuroprotective. And we know that lithium can also can have anti-inflammatory effects and can induce growth factors like BDNF. So it is doing many different things, and it may be that the whole is greater than the sum of the parts. It may not just be one or two, it may be all of the above. So what but I'm not answering the question, which is, what do you tell patients? When patients ask, first of all, what I like to say is lithium is a natural salt. It's an element, it's mined from the earth. It's found in many of our spring waters. For instance, if you drink a Perrier like I do, Perrier has the highest concentration of lithium of any of the mineral waters. So I try to drink Perrier whenever I can. So, you know, I normalize it. I tell patients that. And sometimes that gains a lot of acceptability with a patient, because they'll say, oh, that's natural. That's something that's natural that I can take instead of some artificial medication. And then I tell them it gets into the brain and probably helps to improve nerve cell function, which is what we think it does. And it may also be neuroprotective, and it may help with inflammation and things like that. And it just helps nerve cells communicate better with each other, which is really ultimately how we think a lot of our medicines are working. Ultimately is synaptogenesis, which is not growing new nerve cells. It's making stronger connections, arborization, dendritic spines and synapses. So more connections, more crosstalk. That's good for the brain, and that enhances especially a lot of our circuits and networks, our communication and regulation, the crosstalk between parts of the brain. So when I speak of it in those terms, very often patients can understand. Okay, here's another question. It's interesting. I hadn't considered this one before. What do you think about the use of atomoxetine? I'm sorry, I'm trying to use generic names, and it's fine if you send in brand names, no problem. I'll try to translate. So the use of atomoxetine as a non-scheduled drug versus modafinil for excessive daytime sleepiness. I think that is not a very strong idea, okay? I don't think that one I'm not going to go along with as much, and I'll tell you why. Atomoxetine is mostly, almost entirely, a norepinephrine reuptake inhibitor. Now, that can help with attention and some of the symptoms of ADHD, but actually, if you increase norepinephrine just by itself too much, you can actually make people fatigued and tired and sleepy. So that's the opposite of what you want to do here. Whereas what we think modafinil is doing, as I mentioned, it may be indirectly increasing norepinephrine and dopamine, but we think it may also be enhancing the histamine system. Now, if you think about an antihistamine like diphenhydramine or benztropine, they're highly sedating, at least the sedating ones. You know, the ones we use for allergy now, there are some that don't penetrate the brain as well and are less sedating. Those are sold over the counter for allergies. But the sedating antihistamines, if you block H1 receptors in the brain, histamine 1, that causes sedation and cognitive dulling. So if you do the opposite, if you enhance histamine, either increase the release or stimulate histamine receptors, you're going to increase alertness and concentration and cognition, some measures of cognition. So that would be my strategy more, would be to use modafinil or armodafinil. We also have solriamfetol, which is a hard one to say, which just got sold. A company called Jazz used to promote solriamfetol. They have just sold it to a company called Axsome. Solriamfetol is a norepinephrine dopamine, potent norepinephrine dopamine reuptake inhibitor. Now, that's different from bupropion, which is also probably a norepinephrine dopamine reuptake inhibitor, but a much weaker one. And bupropion may have other ways that it works too. But this solriamfetol is FDA approved for excessive daytime sleepiness from either narcolepsy or obstructive sleep apnea. That's another one that I really like a lot. And that one on paper looks like an antidepressant as well, by the way. So that would be an interesting choice. But atomoxetine, really, I focus that one on really on ADHD. There were some trials of augmentation of SSRIs, but all you're doing there is just creating an SNRI, in my opinion. So, and then my experience with atomoxetine is mixed, as it is for many of you. When it works, but it only seems to work about 30 to 35% of the time. So that obviously limits its use. All right. How good is the evidence for low-dose amisulpiride in the treatment of depression? Boy, that is a real curveball. That's a great question. Well, first of all, amisulpiride is not available in the United States. It is widely available in Europe, and it's very popular, apparently. It is an antipsychotic medication that has some really good evidence on the negative symptoms of schizophrenia and possibly mood. The problem is it does have EPS, a Parkinsonism, and it has some QTC interval prolongation. Also, it strongly elevates prolactin, so that really limits its use. And that may be partly why it was never brought to the United States. So I don't have any personal experience with it. I'm not aware of any good data on the treatment for depression. The person may be thinking, well, you know, I augment with atypical antipsychotics and they're effective, so how about this one? More and more am I a little bit concerned about tardive dyskinesia as a risk. That doesn't stop me from using the effective atypical antipsychotics. Some atypicals have much stronger antidepressant signals than others. For instance, quetiapine, cariprazine, lurasidone, and now lumateperone all have very strong, I would say, and consistent antidepressant signals. But I am concerned, I would be very concerned about using a medicine like amisulpiride. And first of all, it's not available in the U.S. anyway. So anyway, I'm not sure if that helps with your question. I'm just not aware of that data. Okay, what is a good strategy to change from pramipexole to cariprazine in treatment-resistant depression? Wow, this is like PhD plus level question. That's fabulous. All right, well, let's talk a little bit about this. First of all, pramipexole is a dopamine receptor agonist, okay? A dopamine agonist. And there is a lot of evidence, actually, that it can be used as augmentation with an antidepressant for both unipolar and bipolar depression, by the way. My friend Joe Goldberg, who's also a faculty member at NEI, has published on this. It is limited, of course. Pramipexole is limited by significant nausea and orthostatic hypotension, so you have to be careful with your titration. We usually give it two or three times a day. So it's not, you know, my first or second line choice, but it's definitely in the algorithm. Okay, so I have not personally done this switch from pramipexole to cariprazine, although it certainly makes sense. Now, cariprazine is interesting because it's influencing dopamine, as you know, in a very different way. Cariprazine has very high affinity for the D3 receptor and also high affinity for D2, and it's a partial agonist of both D3 and D2. The net-net effect, though, is that it acts like an antagonist in the brain. And that's obvious, because if it was more of an agonist, it would make people manic and psychotic. So D2 antagonist, D3 antagonist. Now, why is that important? There are D3 presynaptic D3 receptors. So D2 and D3 receptors both live presynaptically and postsynaptically. Presynaptically, they act as autoreceptors or regulatory receptors. So for instance, if you have dopamine being released and you have too much dopamine, some of it will float back and bind to the presynaptic receptor, which acts like a shutoff valve, and it'll shut off the release of dopamine. If you block the receptor, therefore, what you do is you're increasing the release of dopamine. So what cariprazine does, we believe, is by blocking those somatodendritic presynaptic D3 autoreceptors, you're basically taking your foot off the brake. You're blocking an autoreceptor, and you increase release of dopamine, especially into the mesocortical pathway, into the prefrontal cortex, where there are D1 receptors. So you're now stimulating the D1 receptors, and that, we think, is beneficial for mood and cognition, and maybe for negative symptoms of schizophrenia. There is a landmark study done in Europe of cariprazine to treat negative symptoms of schizophrenia. It actually statistically significantly beat risperidone. It's one of the only studies we have of one atypical antipsychotic beating another one for anything. So the evidence is there, and certainly there is very good evidence, and it's FDA approved for the treatment of bipolar 1 depression, and there is positive data now on augmentation to an antidepressant for unipolar MDD, and that data is in front of the FDA right now. We fully expect within the next year or so that it might get FDA approved for augmentation. So it's a very reasonable option for treatment-resistant depression, but again, it's working very differently. Oh, the other thing I want to say is you're also stimulating dopamine release into the mesolimbic system, not just mesocortical. But wait a minute, what happens there? If I stimulate dopamine, aren't I going to make you manic or psychotic? Well, that's where our friend the D2 antagonism comes in. D2 antagonism puts the ceiling on that. And so what you're actually doing, though, is you are stabilizing dopamine in the limbic system, which helps mood, but also helps the motivation reward pathways. And so one of the things people have found, a nice niche for cariprazine, is in patients with either schizophrenia or bipolar who have significant substance abuse issues, substance use disorders, because it can stabilize that motivation reward system and stabilize the dopamine system. So a cariprazine is a fascinating animal. Now, the question is, of course, is switching. I don't have a great answer, except I would do it super carefully. I know that. You want to come down off pramipexole very gradually and carefully so you don't get rebound phenomenon. Cariprazine has an extremely long half-life. So one of the things we've learned about cariprazine is you start low, 1.5 milligrams a day perhaps, and you go very slow with your titration. Initially, when it came out, the recommendation was to go too fast. It has a 96-hour half-life. Essentially, it takes 4 weeks to get to steady state. It has almost a week-long half-life. So the other thing is that there are many patients that I started every other day. As a matter of fact, the majority of patients now, I'm doing 1.5 milligrams every other day. And the reason for that is because cariprazine is metabolized by cytochrome P453A4. Well, guess what? There's something people in America smoke that is not tobacco, and it's marijuana. And marijuana inhibits CYP3A4. And it's not only the THC component, it's also CBD. So if they're taking CBD oil and not smoking marijuana, you still have the problem. And so many patients now are either using marijuana or CBD that I just almost assume a lot of them are doing that. So I found that if I start every other day, or some people start even slower than that, because you have a very long half-life, you know, you can do that, it'll hang around. So that's kind of how I initiate cariprazine. I'd be coming off the pramipexole very slowly. I would be concerned, I wouldn't be super concerned, I guess, about too much dopamine, because remember, cariprazine has that D2 antagonism that kind of puts the ceiling on. So I'm not too worried about hemodynamic effects, for instance, things like that. All right, next. Do we have any recommendations on a mood stabilizer for bipolar patient who also likes to drink alcohol? Well, show me a bipolar patient who doesn't like to drink alcohol. I see it a lot in community health. People want treatment, but they don't want to cut out the drinking. The same argument could be made about marijuana. You know, we all have those patients who just don't want to give up their marijuana. Well, first of all, I try to work with the patient, of course, and you want to have a good therapeutic alliance. If the patient is not willing to give up their drug of choice, it's not going to happen right away. But I do plant the seeds. I do talk to them about the fact that, hey, I get it. Your brain has especially a dopamine, you can say chemical imbalance, but it's really a dopamine imbalance. And that's especially true in bipolar patients. And you're self-medicating. Every drug of abuse powerfully stimulates dopamine. It powerfully increases dopamine release, every one of them. Or powerfully stimulates the dopamine system, if not increased release. And certainly that's true for alcohol. The problem is all drugs of abuse have very short half-lives. If you think about it, if you want a drug of abuse, you want a drug that gets into the brain fast, has a big peak, you get a big euphoric rush, and then drops off. Because then you want more and you can feel the buzz again. If it just stayed there all the time, your brain would accommodate, you wouldn't get the high or the buzz anymore. So what I try to do is I say, look, I get it, you're self-medicating. I'm going to give you something that's going to work more effectively and more stably in your brain, if you will. You won't have the same ups and downs. These drugs of abuse are difficult to titrate, in other words, right? So I'm going to tell you, I'm going to give you something that might help and take the place eventually of this other drug that you're using. And so I lay the groundwork to eventually, I want to get them stabilized first on my treatment for bipolar. And then we work on trying to taper off the other things. I also talk very much about healthy lifestyle, exercise, 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 diet, sleep, stress regulation. All of these things are critical to help these people to get away from and encouraging them to find and indulge their hobbies, have social interactions and relationships. That can help fill the void instead of medicine. Now, as far as the best mood stabilizer for someone who likes to drink alcohol, I just mentioned that one that I'm starting to use more now is cariprazine, because it does seem to stabilize the motivation reward system by stabilizing dopamine in the limbic system, especially the nucleus accumbens. That's the pleasure center, the motivation reward center in the brain. So that would certainly be one that I would really consider. Lithium is always reasonable. I sometimes run the lithium levels, though, a little lower. If you run the lithium level too high, a patient like this won't like it. They'll feel dulled and that kind of thing. I use also lamotrigine. I do recommend lamotrigine quite a bit, because lamotrigine is stabilizing mood from below, meaning that most of the drugs for bipolar, most of the so-called mood stabilizers, are great anti-manics. They're stabilizing mood from above. Lamotrigine actually is a little better at treating the depressive symptoms and preventing depression going forward. So it's more pushing up from below, and does a lot of other things, stabilizing membranes and voltage-gated channels in the brain that can be out of whack with alcohol use. So I think that's another one to consider. And I've used lamotrigine and lithium combined with an atypical antipsychotic, principally cariprazine, as I mentioned. All right, we're moving on to a different one. That's a great question. I hope that helped in some way. Okay, now, I have several patients whose anxiety is well controlled during the day, but they wake up every morning in a panic. The panic is usually short-lived, but quite bothersome. Do you have any thoughts on this? I'm at a loss. That is a great one. Well, of course, we would hope that the medicines that are FDA approved include SSRIs. And most of the SSRIs, have a long enough half-life that they're hanging around, so you would hope that that would help. But if that's not helping, and they don't work for everybody, another option would be the pregabalin or gabapentin that I mentioned earlier. I would want to know so much more, though, about this patient. There's so much more you want to know. You want to make sure that medical things are ruled out. You want to make sure their thyroid is taken care of. You want to make sure they don't have sleep apnea. And I got to tell you, since I've started looking more and more for obstructive sleep apnea, I can't believe how often you find it. And patients can wake up with anxiety and panic because their brain's been starved for oxygen during the night. So I find sometimes getting them on CPAP or appropriate treatment can really help. So first, think about medical things. Also, you want to know what other substances are they using. Are they using caffeine, for instance? Coming off of caffeine, caffeine withdrawal can cause anxiety and panic kinds of situations. You want to know about what are their dreams like. You want to know what are their thoughts like here. That could be causing this. Are there any stressors that are going on, any things that they're worrying about? Because when people are asleep, obviously the subconscious mind is very active, and it could be there's something going on there. They may not remember exactly the thought or the dream, but they are left with the emotional residue of it. So you want to know about that. I want to look at all the medicines they're taking. Here's a tip. Here's something I always do. I tell a patient, I want you to fill up a shopping bag with every pill bottle you have in your house. Whether it's prescribed or over the counter, I want to see everything you're taking, and you'll be amazed. You'll see things like a bottle of lorazepam and a bottle of brand name Ativan, and they're taking both. I've seen that. You'll see over the counter things you didn't know that were taking. Many over the counter supplements have stimulants, either obviously or disguised. For instance, guarana seed is actually caffeine. Okay, there's a lot of alkaloids that are basically derivatives or cousins of cocaine. They're stimulants, right? So you want to know all these things they're taking, because you might be surprised that they're taking something here that could be causing this. I want to know what other medications they're being prescribed from other prescribers that I don't know about. I want to know if there's drug-drug interactions going on, things like that. I want to know what her glucose is doing. Is this somebody who is very prone to hypoglycemia, for instance? So if they go too long overnight without eating and they wake up and their blood sugar is low, and so they're having panic from that, or a sympathetic overdrive can happen and cause that. So all of these things, I hope, are helpful, at least in thinking through what could be going on. As far as a specific treatment, I can't recommend it yet until I know maybe which of these things could be going on. So hopefully that's helpful. Certainly you also can use, if you need to, PRN benzodiazepines in the right patient, for the right thing, as long as you've ruled out these other things, might be something to consider. Okay. There's a patient on aripiprazole 5 milligrams and risperidone 1 milligrams. Now, that is an interesting combo. Oh, boy, if Jonathan Meyer heard that one, he would go through the roof, and I'll tell you why in a second. He has a fine resting tremor, doesn't want anything to treat it, doesn't want to change meds. Is that okay? The patient has schizophrenia. Okay. I hate to tell you this, but that regimen makes no sense, and I'll tell you why. Aripiprazole, the D2 partial agonists, the so-called ABC drugs, aripiprazole, brexpiprazole, cariprazine, have super high affinity for the D2 receptor. Super high. Higher than any of the other drugs. That means that if you give them with any other antipsychotic, they crowd it out of the way. So this patient is not getting any D2 blockade from the risperidone. So the risperidone is not adding anything to the antipsychotic effect, believe it or not. Now, it could be that there are other receptors, other receptor activities risperidone is binding to that could be in some way helpful, I don't know. But my first recommendation is to pick one of these two and go with whichever one you want, but optimize the dose. These are both very low doses. For a patient with schizophrenia, usually we have to use higher than 5 milligrams of aripiprazole or higher than 1 milligram of risperidone. But you're getting the tremor undoubtedly from the combination, and I would say to pick one and try one first at an appropriate dose if you can. There are also, of course, other medications, especially the newer ones, that have much less risk of EPS kind of symptoms like Parkinsonism, if you will. It sounds like you might have a hard time getting the patient to try something else. They don't want to change medicines, but they might be happy to try to get rid of one of those two and maximize the other one. So hopefully that's helpful to you. Okay, let's see, what time do we have here? Oh my, it is after 3:30, we've gone a little bit over, which is great. Thank you so much. I want to thank you all so much. And listen, if you've enjoyed this, or if you want to check out our Synapse virtual meeting, please consider becoming a member if you're not of NEI. Please go to our website to find out more information. It's www.neiglobal.com. That's www.neiglobal.com. We have so many educational offerings, products, meetings, services, videos. You can also check out our YouTube channel, which is NEI Psychopharm on YouTube, and you'll see some fun videos there. Our focuser videos are very entertaining. And I really want to thank you again. And come back and see us next month in May when our Ask NEI is going to be on the topic of schizophrenia, which is the topic of our Saturday morning live, which is on the third Saturday in May. What date is that? Saturday morning live in May. Do we know? Let's check it out. May 24th or 14th, actually. It might be the 14th. It's on a Saturday. I thought it was the 3rd, but I think it's actually the 14th. Isn't that great? I should know that. I think it's May 14th. Anyway, Saturday in May is going to be schizophrenia. Join me and Dr. Les Citrome, who are going to be giving talks and taking your questions and answers. So thanks so much. Have a wonderful day, and thanks for watching.